And we're going to go ahead and reconvene to the regular meeting at 6:06 p.m. The governing board meetings are held in the boardroom at the Ben Furlong Education Center, located at 8700 South Kyrene Road, Tempe. We regularly meet on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. However, there is only one board meeting in December. All meetings begin at 7 o'clock p.m. We welcome community involvement and encourage people to come to board meetings and be involved in our community. School board meetings are held in public. To conduct the business of the district, board meetings will be streamlined on the internet and then posted on the Kyrene YouTube channel, which can be accessed by going to our website at kyrene.org and clicking on the YouTube icon at the bottom left side. Board agendas may be obtained from the district office and the Kyrene website 24 hours in advance of each board meeting. Our superintendent, Dr. David Schauer, senior leadership directors, and interested citizens are with us here tonight. Item 2.02, moment of silence, and I don't see any children, so I will go ahead and lead the moment of silence and followed by the pledge. Thank you. Okay, 2.04, roll call. Will board members state their names for the record? Let the record show. Oh, sorry.
Michelle Hirsch.
Kristen Middleton.
John King.
At Coggins. Let the record show that four board members are present. Are there any changes tonight on the agenda?
We have one change that we'd like to make, and then John might have another one. But it is item 7.07. There was a wording or a typo actually in there, and so Mark Knight is going to correct that for us. And so if we pull that off and make it an action item, it would become item 8.09. So that's one change. And then John, did you have another one?
Yeah, 7.08 and 0.09 I also wanted to pull off for further discussion.
Okay. So those would become action items then in the 8 section. Got that, Cindy?
Okay, may I have a motion to approve tonight's amended agenda?
Move to approve tonight's agenda as amended.
Second.
Okay, the motion by Michelle Hirsch, second by Kristen Middleton. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. 4.01, Superintendent's Briefing, Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, members of the board. This is a very brief briefing tonight. I did want to mention that we have some major staff developments starting tomorrow. And so we'll be at the Mesa Convention Center with about 400 teachers on the 27th and 28th for staff development in professional learning communities. So this is a continuation of what we did last year. And last year we had about 200, was it? So this year we're expanding that and we're really excited to be doing this again. So 2 days of training coming up. The other thing I wanted to mention is that Summer Academy is starting Monday and enrollment is doing extremely well. And Summer Academy staff would love it if board members were interested in touring a little bit some of the sites where that's happening. So if you're interested in that, just let us know and we can arrange for you to see learning in the summertime in Kyrene. So that's it for tonight. Thanks.
Thank you. Item 4.02, do board members have anything to report? Mrs. Hirsch?
Thanks. I wanted to let you all know that I'm a superhero. I usually leave my cape at home, but I was invited as a superhero in the community to read last week at the Guadalupe Branch Library. And kids were, of course, adorable. But I found the most fun book, and I just wanted to share. It's called The Day the Crayons Quit. And I got the book a few days ahead and was reading through it and poor everybody that walked through my house, they had to listen to the book because, and they all laughed, grown-ups laughed. So it's a very funny story about crayons that quit and the reasons why. And I just had a great time over there at the library. And they, the Guadalupe Branch Library, kicks off their summer reading program on Monday, and they will have all kinds of fun activities to encourage kids to participate in reading all summer. And actually, all the Maricopa Branch libraries have the same superhero reading program. So if you happen to be in Ahwatukee and you want to go to that library, or Chandler and you want to go to that library, that's good too. I also attended the Pima Medical Institute graduation at the beautiful Chandler Center for the Arts last Friday. And I knew nothing about Pima Medical Institute, but I had a friend that was graduating in their nursing assistant program, and it was really quite impressive. So I just like to share when I find out something as far as advanced training and education. It was their first graduating class of paramedics, and many of them are already firefighters, but it was impressive in that every single one of their graduates not only passed the exam with 100%, but the national average is 70%. So they're doing a good job over there, I think, and it was a very inspiring. They have a lot of programs for kids past high school for training. So that was a fun event, and I wanted to share that. Thanks.
Mr. King?
You sure they weren't grading on a curve? this week we had graduation at, or promotion at all the schools, and one thing struck me this year. I've done this every year since I've been on the board, but this year it struck me probably more than other years, the camaraderie that exists between the students and between the students and the teachers. And I think it speaks volumes about how connected the teachers become with their students. One teacher hugged every single student in that pod. Everyone. She was just awesome. And when some of the kids came up, well, most of the kids came up, all the other kids were screaming for them and all. That's what really made it special. And I know this is kind of a special thing, but I just really wanted to acknowledge the fact that the teachers are really connecting with their students, and I think that really makes a difference. There was a very positive atmosphere. That was at Centennial, by the way.
Thank you, John. You know, for me, Michelle says she was a superhero. I felt like one as well because I was able to witness graduating one more of my boys. So I've had two graduate that went through Kyrene, went through Tempe Union, and now they're both off to ASU. Well, one's at ASU and one's off. But one thing, as I was sitting in the audience, looking down and realizing that I would say a large percentage of all of those students were Kyrene graduates. To see, again, the camaraderie and to see these young adults and their future ahead of them. And it made me reflect on how so many of these kids grew up together, and furthermore, how we are so connected and how we need to continue to work with our Tempe Union High School and our universities, because, you know, it doesn't stop when they graduate and promote through Kyrene. It doesn't stop when they graduate from the high school, and it certainly doesn't and shouldn't stop when they, you know, get to college, and the sky's the limit. And I think that, you know, it's exciting to be a part of something, and I think it, when you sit here at this dais and we do the hard work that we do, to see those diplomas being handed out, there's some gratitude there. So I just want to thank, you know, all the teachers, the administration, all the parents, because, you know, amongst the tears, and then I thought, oh gosh, no one had to hear me read my "Oh, the Places You'll Go" this year. So I even made my son listen to it. But again, I always say, if you haven't read the book, you need to pull the Dr. Seuss "Oh, the Places You'll Go," whether it be kindergarten, middle school, high school, college. It's really just such a great book. So thanks and congratulations to all the graduates. Okay, so we are moving on to 5.01, request to speak to the governing board. As per ARS 38-43.02 G and H, the public may request to address the governing board. Members of the audience may address any item not on the agenda. Please fill out the blue form provided at the sign-in table and submit it to the board secretary at this time. If you have not done so already, Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes each. State statute prohibits the governing board from discussing an item that is not on the agenda, but they do listen and request that the staff follow up on any concerns. Do we have any blue cards? Okay, we will move on to 6.01, which is an item that we leave there for the budget. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam Vice President and members of the board. We, as you know, we have this item on here in case someone has a question about the budget that we'll be voting on later this summer. So if there's anything you wanted to bring up, this is the time to do it, and Jeremy's available to answer any questions if you have any.
I have a question. How do we pay for college now?
Okay.
So we will move on to 7.0, Consent Agenda. As amended, may I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I'll move to approve the amended consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion by Mr. King, second by Mrs. Hirsch. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. 8.0, action items. We're going to go ahead and we're going to go right to 8.01. Principal for Apprende Middle School,
yes,
Dr. Schauer.
We're excited to be able to celebrate this decision with you tonight, and we have three people that we'll be bringing forward. The first one is Renee Corey, and she will be our next principal at Apprende Middle School. And Renee has been an assistant principal in the Higley School District for the past 3 years in grades 7 and 8, so she knows middle school kids well. She was also an assistant principal in the Cartwright School District for a couple of years in grades 6 through 8. And the Apprende interview team particularly liked her experience in implementing a one-to-one device program in the school where she currently is, because as you know, that's something that's going on right now. And so we would like to ask you to approve Renee Corey as the next principal of Apprende Middle School, and then ask her to come forward and say a couple words.
I'll move we approve Renee Corey as the new principal of Apprende Middle School.
I'll second.
Okay, motion by Mrs. Hirsch, second by Mrs. Middleton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. And now you get to give us a little speech.
I don't know about a speech, but just want to say good evening, and I'm so appreciative and excited to be a part of the Kyrene and specifically the Apprende team. So ready to get started, so excited. So again, I thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for the approval. And again, appreciate it and ready to be part of the Kyrene team. So thanks so much. Have a great summer.
Thank you. Okay, 8.02, principal for Akimal.
So next is Stephanie Phillips, and she will be our next principal at Akimal. And Stephanie has been an assistant principal in the Douglas Unified School District for the past 3 years at the high school level. Prior to that, she worked in Gilbert, Scottsdale, and Phoenix as a teacher on special assignment. She's also been an ESL teacher, and she has experience that expands over the last 20 years or so. And the Akimal staff really noted that she was bilingual. They thought that was important, and they appreciated her collaborative leadership style. So Stephanie, let's celebrate Stephanie. Oh, and don't forget to vote.
Shin.
Getting kind of pushy there, David. Yeah. I'll make the motion to approve Stephanie Phillips as the new principal of Akimal Middle School.
Second.
Motion by Mr. King, second by Mrs. Hirsch. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Yay.
Good evening. I did just want to take this opportunity to thank you and tell you how excited I am to be part of this great school community. I got to spend the day today at Akimal and meet several of the people. And before I even got here, I was literally bombarded with emails and welcoming me, and it just let me know what a fabulous staff they have there and how excited I am to be part of it. So thank you again.
Thank you. Okay, 8.03, Dr. Schauer.
And next is Suzanne Raimondo, and she will be the next principal of Monte Vista Elementary School. And Suzanne has worked in Kyrene and Roosevelt School Districts. She was originally here and then went to Roosevelt. She's got a lot of different experiences, including special education teacher, classroom teacher, literacy and math coach, and dean. And the Monta Vista staff really appreciated her strong instructional background. They thought that was really important, and her emphasis on putting the needs of children first. And we all know that about Suzanne. And Suzanne is one of our own, so we're excited to promote her. So Suzanne Raimondo.
I am very pleased to make a motion to approve Suzanne Raimondo as the new principal of Monta Vista.
I'll second.
Okay, motion by Mrs. Hirsch, second by Mrs. Middleton. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes 4-0.
Good evening. Thank you, Madam President, Dr. Schauer, and members of the board. I am humbled and honored to be named principal of Monta Vista. Last week, I had a chance to go meet students and parents and staff, and I am just overwhelmed by how warm and welcoming they have been to me. In a very short time, I've come to learn that Monta Vista has high expectations for all. So I have a lot to rise up to. They put children first, and it's a part of their every decision that they make. It's a school where staff values their contributions and then collaboratively thrive together. It's a school that they've taken pride in the parent and partnerships that they've formed with the school over time, and that's something I'm really proud to be a part of. I am proud to call Monta Vista my new home and to lead this fine school in the 2015-16 school year. I'm going to ask for a little bit more time just to, I don't think this moment would have ever been possible without the key individuals in my life. So as an employee of 25 years in Kyrene, I've had the fortune to have amazing mentors along the way. I want to start by thanking Dr. Gina Taylor, my first principal. Dr. Taylor, I don't know that I'll ever be able to capture the words of what I have learned from you, but you have always recognized my potential well before I recognize it in myself. I also want to thank Carrie Fuerty for 3 amazing years together as a leadership team. You have shared your vision, empowered me to grow, and you've believed in me over the years. Thank you for showing me the value of honesty, integrity, and trust, and have inspired me to grow and spread my wings. I also want to just thank my family, because they've been there through all of it. So I'm excited. Tomorrow we begin the hard work at the PLCs, and I'm just excited to be a part of this. So thank you.
Thank you. Lots to celebrate tonight. Okay, so we will move on to 8.04, Certified Tentative Agreement for the 2014-15 school year.
Thank you, Madam Vice President, members of the board. The first thing I'd like to do is thank our meet and confer teams for the hours they put into this process, and they do a great job, and I think Mark will probably tell us about who some of those people are. But you have the agreements in front of you, and I think Mark will make a comment about them. And then if you have any questions, you can certainly ask. So, Dr. Knight.
Susan, are you the official representative? Okay. Thank you, Dr. Schauer. As Vice President, serving as President and Governing Board, members of the community, before you is a summary of the tentative agreements that we have worked on all year. And as you know, we've gone to almost a year-round meet confer process. And so I wanted to thank Susan and the team that she's nominated to help us lead the work forward. And so I just wanted to make sure that I was available and Susan's available to answer any questions you might have regarding the tentative agreements. There's a summary there. Of course, you've seen these several times over the months in terms of board memos, but I just want to be available for any questions. And again, thanks to Susan and the team.
Thank you.
Good evening, Governing Board Vice President and members of the board and Dr. Schauer. I don't sit on the meet and confer team. I sit in the back of the room for that process. And Scott Wilson, the chair of the meet and confer for the teachers, isn't available tonight to be here. But he has signed the agreement, the tentative agreements for the meet and confer team. And we have some language changes this year. We have some things about PLC and Wednesdays, which is probably one of the bigger items that's on there. And some of the things that we cleaned up in language, which there were some things that had to be corrected, things that had to come from the benefits department to be in alignment with some things. I think those were the main things that we made for changes. It's a long list, but some of them were just like really kind of updating the document also for kind of taking care of other things that were part of state statute and policy and things like that. So if you have any questions about the process, I can help answer those questions for you.
Mrs. Hirsch?
Thanks. So I swallowed some water wrong, so sorry. I do have a question about tentative agreement number 4 and the Wednesday language or early release restructured week language. I understand a little bit about the work of professional learning communities and the importance, and I'm reading this great book that Nancy Branch gave me years ago. And but just help me understand that the Wednesday seems like in the past that it has been so critical for individual teacher plan time. And there's only so many hours in the day, I get that. But it feels like they're being forced to have a professional learning community time at some schools. I understand it's not going to happen at all schools because the way that their time is structured. But can you speak to whether some teachers will start school in the fall and all of a sudden realize that they don't have their Wednesday plan time, individual plan time that they thought they had?
Well, we've actually been talking about that at Rep Council since like really about back in March when we saw that was one of the items on the agenda that they wanted to address. And so I think that one of the things we have to look at with Wednesdays is this. We had people doing all kinds of things we have teams. I think it was some of the information came back that a lot of people were meeting even more than once a week. We had some people who stood behind the document and said, you can't make me meet on this day. And so we had this wide spectrum of views on what Wednesday afternoon was for. And it really goes back historically to when the teachers at the last few schools in the district that didn't have early release Wednesdays were saying this was about hours of time because they were giving up 2 hours during the rest of the week, adding time to the schedule to create an early release on Wednesday. So there's a lot of history before I was here, but a lot of teachers did share that history with me, and I shared it with the meet and confer team. And so, and some of them were well aware of that. One of the things that I shared with the Rep Council was that, you know, 8 years ago when I came to work in Kyrene, we always met on Wednesdays at 1 o'clock as a team. We didn't call it PLC, but we did things like quarterly assessments, ongoing assessments. And I was in a school with the current president at that time that was part of the association. So we did it just because that was always what the language was. The language was always that it was by collaboration. It was intended for that. And so then we had people that were all over the board, some people who would refuse to meet, some people who did it much more often than that. So one of the things that they left in the language was, it is still between administrators and staff to decide what works best for them. Because it doesn't even apply to some schools like CMS, because they already have 4 periods a week where they meet as a PLC on a daily basis. So there still needs to be that understanding and agreement that staff and teachers should, or the principal with the, you know, the really teachers and the principal should make that decision together for what works best for them. The one thing I think that really has changed is that we've asked for an agreement to be at least that you meet once a week, which that really wasn't in there. And different schools were picking once a month, all the way down to some people meet 4 times a week. And truly, a true PLC that I see in action, they're not doing it with the issue about an agenda or about a meeting. It's about the work that they do together as a team. And so I don't want, I mean, I really don't want teachers to get lost behind that whole part, or administrators for that part, that it's about the agenda. Because that's where the frustration is really coming from teachers. It's about that part about, you know, most of us are being very professional and meeting with our teams and working collaboratively. And the only thing I've asked of administrators here is to make sure that their leaders all have the training that they need to really lead PLC schools. Because that seems to be where some of the issues come in for teachers.
I agree. And like I said, I know a little bit about PLCs, and it doesn't seem like it's about having an agenda and taking minutes and being forced as much as it is collaborating the staff and the administration and what works for that school. And so by approving this agreement tonight, we aren't approving that it has to be Wednesday and there has to be an agenda and there. I mean, that's my concern, is that exactly what you said is we're honoring that.
We did agree that there's a common agenda form that everyone uses across the district that's just a standard form. I know a lot of teachers who don't use it every time they walk into a meeting, and other people just update it, and some people do. You know, so the agenda isn't really in the language. I don't believe that it's in the language at all. One of the things I just keep saying, a PLC is not about a meeting, and a PLC is not about an agenda. And really, I think we're the teachers who expressed frustration. I haven't had the time to read through all of the comments from all of the teachers who took the time in the last few weeks of school where they were really busy. You know, and I do hear what they have to say, and it's about time. I mean, I don't think anyone understands how much time classroom teachers are spending, especially in the elementary school, to be prepared to instruct students every day, and especially when teachers are being moved around in different classrooms, have to do unwrapping standards, find curriculum resources to create that. So the time is a really big deal for our classroom teachers. It really is. There's just not enough of it. There's not enough money, and there's not enough time. So this is one of the things that I see that it's frustrating, but I also saw that there was, I think it was 60% of the people already meet at least once a week. So how do we bring teachers together to see that this is the only way that we're going to get our work done, is if we work together collaboratively and you know, with some, you know, cooperation. I see teams that aren't going to want to meet on Wednesdays from 1, but they meet every day during their regular planning time. You know, the idea is that PLCs meet on a regular basis to do that work together, which is really about assessments and pre-assessments. And I hear it when I'm at CELO, I hear teachers talk about kids learning all the time in the lunchroom. It really is like ongoing PLCs, but there needs to be a little bit more to it that's formal to document a little bit of it. That's why the agenda form was agreed to, like, informally last year, that we, you know, almost all the staffs had a conversation and they agreed we could use a similar form. Although there are some complaints that it's kind of cumbersome and not really exactly what teachers need. But I say, bring something better forward that works for you or whatever. You know?
But if the team is meeting at another time besides Wednesday, then they don't have to comply with the Wednesday early release time.
And it does say that in there.
Okay.
That administrators and, it's in there. It is in there.
Yes. Okay.
Right. But I think the minimum part is that you meet at least once a week, because really, I think that's the part where we're all over the board about how frequently people were meeting and then not meeting, and so.
And to make it important that they meet once a week, I can see the value in that. A lot of what I've read is that it has to grow as the staff is comfortable, you know. And so I just don't want to feel like teachers are going to come back in the fall to their schools and see that, and I know they don't just come back in the fall, but I just don't want this to be approved today when school is out, essentially, and then in the fall we hear all this concern from teachers that they've lost their plan time. So I hope that administration and principals work with teachers to make sure that the staff and the teachers are collaborating, and we're just not putting more burden on teachers so that we've taken away their plan time. And in some of these case studies, they give teachers more money for that plan time. And wouldn't it be great if we could look at that? Because it's just like you said, there's so much more that they're expected to do, and we don't want to take away that time.
That time. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. King?
Can we get rid of all of these? No, I'm only kidding.
Well, I actually, my own personal position is, and I just say this, I believe that 99% of our teachers out there are very professional and go above and beyond in this school district.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
And I think that that's really evident. And every once in a while, it's, you know, there's things that are happening to teachers with stress, and all the demands of the profession are at an all-time high on teachers. And so I just want to say that, you know, personally, I feel less language is better, but that's, I'm not on the meet and confer team. I support what they do. That's what I do. My job is to stand behind them and support them.
Number 10, this the one I have question on. The way that I'm reading this is the multiple certification position related stipend, that if a teacher teaches two courses that are difficult to find to fill, I think that's the term, right? That we should be giving them a stipend to encourage them to teach that. So, dumb question is, do teachers teach more than one course on a regular basis?
No. This only pertains to a handful of teachers. However, there are a few positions where, you know, for example, in middle school, we might have a teacher who teaches two sections of science and two sections of math, which really creates an additional planning burden for those teachers. And also, we have federal requirements and state requirements in terms of highly qualified and state certification. So in those situations where we ask teachers to actually teach in multiple content areas that requires multiple certifications, we thought that a stipend would be a nice an inducement to get them to agree to that kind of
so
situation.
Which really takes me to my real question, which is, what is a stipend? In this case, it doesn't say what it is. It just, they get a pat on the back, or what?
Oh, it's $1,000 stipend. It matches the stipend that we use for preschool, because preschool teachers have to be early childhood endorsed as well as special ed endorsed. So it matches that.
And they're all okay with that?
You mean the five or six teachers that are in that situation? I think they'll be very happy because they're doing it for free right now, but we've had a couple of issues to track.
Well, you know, I mean, I think in the example you use, math and science, those are very difficult courses to teach. So I'm just wondering, if they say a stipend is what they want, I'm not going to advocate for anything else, but I'm surprised that it's not, we want to put them on a different pay schedule or something. So,
I mean, that could be one thing we'll take a look at. I mean, basically, we take a look at, we are able to fill those positions with difficulty, but we do fill them. It's just a matter of keeping people in those positions. So this is a baby step in moving to separate pay schedules.
And then the last question is, the reason they teach both math and science is because there's just not enough teachers out there that teach math or that teach science? Or is it that you want them to teach both?
I think it's very few teachers are able to teach both.
Okay, that's the key, is
yeah,
that they can teach
both.
It's
the and, yeah.
Okay.
Not the or.
All right, thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, can I get a motion to approve the 12 tentative agreements worked on during the certified meet and confer process for the 14-15 school year?
So moved.
Point of question. I knew I would forget this. Is that right, the 14-15 school year, or is it the 15-16 school year?
For the 15-16.
Okay, so it.
Oh, good catch. So I'll approve the certified tentative agreements for the 15-16 school year that are outlined here.
I'll second.
Okay, I have a motion from Mrs. Hirsch, second by Mrs. Middleton. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Thank you. Okay, moving on to 8.05, Education Support Professionals tentative agreement for the 15-16 school year.
Thank you for the good catch there, too. Before you is a summary of the tentative agreements we have for the ESP meet confer session. And just like the certified teachers, we meet with the support staff throughout the entire year. And do we have any CUSPA representatives? We do not tonight. But they also have a team led by Mike Williams, and we meet with them monthly. And you have a summary of the tentative agreements before you. I'm available for any questions.
Hirsch?
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't turn it off. And you didn't turn it off, so I don't really have a question.
If I can hit the microphone right, it'll come on. All right, so the difference between the one we just did in 8.4, that was for certified, and this is for the support, the education support professionals.
That's correct.
Right? But some of these things seem similar to me. Was that intentional?
One of the directions we've been moving in the past several years is when there is a similar issue that faces all three employee groups, we try to either go wall to wall or we share some of the brainstorming solutions that we're coming up with the other team. And so you'll notice that some of these solutions are similar across all three employee groups. For example, the performance-based retention language, as you recall, last year we came up with a wall-to-wall recommendation to the governing board at the seventh year that an employee has successful experience in Kyrene, there's that incentive for the 2.5% structure increase. And so that would be something that we work together on a wall-to-wall agreement across all three employee groups. That'd be an example.
Okay. Number two is the one that I wanted to talk about. What's significant about February 15th?
That's the date that we use for many, many things. One of them, though, is the professional growth. And so when employees are taking classes, they need to submit those eligible credits for compensation by February 15th.
Okay. Is the compensation retroactive to anything, or does it start at a certain point and go on?
It starts July 1 of the following year.
Okay, got it. I think that was the thing that got me. I didn't know if February 15th was significant because it brought in, you know, prior hours or time or something. Okay, yeah, thanks.
Okay, may I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to accept to
approve.
Thank you. Couldn't think of the word. To approve the education support professionals tentative agreements for the year 2015-2016. There you go.
I'll move the second.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. King, a second by Mrs. Middleton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Okay, now we are moving on to 8.07, the ASBA, 8.06, all this fun tentative agreements. This one is for the administrative agreement for the 15-16 school year. Mr. Knight?
Hey, thank you. And I'm turning to see if we can pack up representatives. I don't think so tonight. So, just like the other two employee groups, we meet with the administrators monthly throughout the course of the entire year. And before you are the tentative agreements for that group. And there are a couple of agreements that look similar to the other employee groups because we did discuss this across all three groups. But I'm available for any questions you may have.
Mrs. Hirsch?
Thanks. I just want to clarify and maybe highlight agreement number three. The suspension of professional growth allowance for the 15-16 school year as one of the budget balancing strategies. Now, that would be if our principals or other administrators took advanced training and schooling and wanted to be reimbursed. We are not doing that for just that employee group this coming up here?
That's correct. With administrators, one of the conditions that they have in their employment contract is an ability to draw upon an allowance of $1,100 to do exactly as you described. And we're recommending that be suspended for next year as one of our budget balancing strategies.
And I get that we have to balance this budget, but I think it's important to highlight that that's one employee group that will not be given that that allowance. And, you know, we want all of our employees, but particularly our school leaders, to have as much professional development training as makes sense. So I just wanted to highlight that it's unfortunate and I don't know if all principals agree with that, but I want to thank them for that and hang in there. Hopefully we won't have to do that again next year. Thanks.
Well, thank you for pointing that out.
Mr. King.
Number eight, add a 0.5% increase to the hiring guidelines and salary placement structure to try and stay competitive. Can you give me something more than that?
One of the initial ideas, we were talking about what to do about compensation for next year. You saw a lengthy presentation from Fox Lawson on the recommendations. We know that we are falling farther and farther behind with administrative and certified compensation. With support staff, I think it's hit and miss depending on which position you're talking about. We felt like for our continuing employees, we felt like a salary freeze would not be appropriate. We need to do something so we don't create that bump issue that you've heard about in the past. We also felt that we should increase the starting salary structure for our new administrators to at least reflect that same 0.5% increase. It doesn't get us anywhere close to what our competitors are doing, but we have to keep moving in that direction to stay competitive. Hopefully next year, when you take a look at the second year of Fox Lawson's recommendations, we can start coming up with some strategies to be competitive in terms of compensation.
You know, I'm not really against this, but I am concerned because I'm just wondering, we had to take a big cut this year. We're going to have to do the same thing again next year, maybe not as big. We're going to have to but we keep adding all this stuff in there. And so somewhere along the way, we're going to reach diminishing returns. Right, Jeremy? And so I'm just going to caution you right now that I'm going to challenge every one of these things, not because I disagree with them. That's because I don't know where the money's coming from. And it's not coming from our traditional sources like it used to. And I don't think we're going to see it come back anytime soon. So I appreciate what you're saying. I don't know who our competitors are, but if they're in this state, they're faced with the same challenge as we are. And if they're able to find a way to do this, then we should probably be able to do that too. But I don't want this affecting the classroom, ever. Okay, that's my point.
And I agree with you, Mr. King, as far as we have to pay attention so that when we add, we take a look at where if we're not getting any more money, we have to take a look at where we can cut in other places. And that's why I hope in the next year's budget discussions that we are able to do some of the things we've talked about and look at some things more closely. I noticed a couple items that we're paying more for than we used to, and by several hundred thousand dollars. So it would be advantageous to look at all the departments, and I know that's our plan, and see where we can cut so that we can accommodate some compensation increases to at the very least be competitive with our neighboring districts. I know that years ago, 15, 20 years ago, when I was a parent in Kyrene, everyone thought, and it was true, that Kyrene paid as well or better than neighboring districts, and we just don't have that anymore. So if we want the best, we all know people that are leaving to go to other districts, even for $1,000, $2,000, $3,000. So I think that this goal to keep increase our compensation for the people that work in our buildings and help us achieve student results is a good thing. But at the same time, we need to look at where we can save in other areas. And I believe there are places we can save. So I hope we look at that next year. Thanks.
Thank you. And I would agree as well. I mean, I would hate for us to down the road get to a point where we're back where we were 5 years ago, 4 years ago. Thank you. Okay, may I get a motion for 8.06?
I'll move to approve the administrative tentative agreements for 2015-16 school year.
I'll second.
Okay, motion by Mrs. Hirsch, second by Mr. King. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Now we will move on to 8.07, which is the ASBA political agenda that comes to us every year.
Thank you, Madam Vice President and members of the board. You delegated Kristen Middleton to deal with this issue, and so Kristen developed the list, and it was provided in the last board memo, or I think it was, it came out, you know, before the weekend anyway. So hopefully you've had a chance to look at that, and this is your opportunity to discuss that and take action.
Mr. King?
I just want to ask this. What we're looking at here, this is just from our board? Or is this a comprehensive list that comes from SBA? It's a drill down list from ASBA.
This is just from our board.
Okay.
So, you know, I will just go back and give a little history of my experience with the ASBA legislative committee considerations for the political agenda. You know, each year we've kind of tweaked it, how we've done it. What we've done is we've been given, the pack used to be, I think, you know, several pages, and we would go through and pick our top three, and then we would sit down as a board and decide what we thought. Then we, I think that through the duration, we decided that we were putting maybe a little bit too much time into it. We ultimately agreed on because, you know, the information that was provided for us was pretty, what's a good way to say it? It was broad. It was nothing too controversial. And then as we, you know, came to this point for this year, they really streamlined it. There weren't as many options. And as a board, we felt that It would be suited and fine to have a board member as long as we all gave some of our recommendations. So I think, you know, as I've looked through these, you know, I will say that the first year that I was, I'll use an example, that I was on the board, we were having funding issues regarding funding free all-day kindergarten. And at that time, it wasn't that I didn't support all-day kindergarten. It was, how are we going to fund it, and was it going to be something that was going to cut into another program. So that would not have been one of my top that year. Of course, I support all-day kindergarten. So I think one thing that we want to caution and we want to make sure is that this is what we submit is not too controversial, that it encompasses really the will of the board. So with that, I want to see, are there any concerns, anything on here that anyone wants to discuss?
Push my button. Did I just start?
Okay, yeah. I don't know who pushed the button.
You go first.
Michelle, you're the girl.
It doesn't matter.
Ladies first. Sorry, John.
Okay, under long-term issues, just so the public knows what we're even talking about, long-term issues that we think should be core beliefs or addressed over the next 5 to 10 years, and I'm assuming Kristen took input from all of us, and then either the majority of answers were listed as 1, 2, 3. And just for the board to be clear, what ASBA provided was, like you said, very streamlined, but we can add whatever we want. So to uphold preservation of local control, to reinforce the connection between the community and its elected governing board members, I'm all for that. Structurally change the school finance formula, I'm all for that. And meet the unique educational needs of every student so they reach their full potential, I'm all in favor of that. The short-term issues that ASBA is saying could be accomplished over 3 to 5 years, and ASBA is Arizona School Boards Association, in case there's anybody, you know how I hate those acronyms, and then I'm doing it myself. Short-term issues, the first one here is maximize land trust for teachers' salaries and student classroom opportunities, or maximize land trust income. So I don't really understand that, but if most board members think that's a good thing. I'm all for maximizing teacher salaries.
I don't understand it either.
Yeah. And then the second one is allow public tax credits to be used as determined by school districts. I'm all for that. And the third one, to be more restrictive in how bond money and override money can be used. I would just be interested in why maybe that was suggested. Why are examples of ways to be more restrictive? We're kind of restricted in how we use bond money now, but and override money. But is there anybody that can weigh in what would be some examples of being more restrictive or why we should support this as a board?
But I heard something along the way that there was an interest in looking at this to help the districts, the voters in the districts, to understand how that money would be used, instead of saying it's a capital budget override or it's a technology override. If it's saying, well, we're gonna supply this, you know, something a little more drilled down that gives some specific language there that says this is what it's going to be used for. Bond, I don't know how you do that, because it's, you know, there's so many things that you can do there. At any time, I don't know, maybe you can address this, Jeremy. And you're touching your microphone. Give me a chance.
I can speak to what the current restrictions are for bond and override. I can't speak to what additional restrictions could be added onto that. So the current restrictions for bond, right now, bonds can only be used to improve the life of the building or purchasing of new buildings and everything else. So, for instance, other items, with one small exclusion. So other items that don't add value to the building. So let's say we wanted to move this projector from being right here to being to the other side of the room. We can't pay for that out of bond dollars. That doesn't increase the value of this building whatsoever. If there's a part that's a component part of a large piece of equipment, like our air conditioner or chiller or something, and that component part needs to be replaced, not the entire, you know, air conditioning system, but just one part, you can't use bond dollars to do that. That doesn't improve the life of the building. So bonds are restricted in that manner. One provision that was passed for bonds several years ago, especially as the state started cutting capital and people didn't have places to go to for capital, they did open up one provision to give a little bit more flexibility, and that was some limitations around using it for furniture, equipment, and technology. So now you can use a portion of your bond can be used for furniture, equipment, and technology, but it's a small portion, and there's some restrictions around that. In addition to that, any item that you want to purchase out of bond has to be covered by what was stated in your bond pamphlet. So the way that we've stated, allotted $28 million to be used for pupil transportation. We've allotted $4.5 million to be used for this complex, and we have the balance that's allotted for maintaining our school. So we have to follow those guidelines. We couldn't switch and all of a sudden say, you know what, we're actually going to spend $40 million out of the bond on the district office complex. So it's already limited also to what you put in that pamphlet and what your voters voted on and approved. When you do the pamphlet, you have to form a capital improvement plan. And, you know, our capital improvement plan is maintained on our website, kyrene.org/CIP, and you can see every project that's scheduled by year and by school. So if we're going to replace the roof at a school, you'll see that that's scheduled for 2017. Now, when we get to 2017, if the roof is holding up just fine and we're not reporting a lot of leaks for that roof, then we can always push that out. So we can adjust our CIP as our needs change, and we assess that. But still, it needs to be on our capital improvement plan if we're going to pay for it out of bond.
Can I just clarify, if something's on the capital improvement plan, like a roof, for example,
yes,
and you determine that it does need replacing,
yes,
you still have to bring it in front of the board,
yes,
for approval.
You still vote on every single one of those contracts.
So, right. So if the majority of the board didn't feel they wanted to use bond money to pay for the roof or whatever the item was, you wouldn't get to do it.
You can deny any project, even if it is on the capital improvement plan. If the board doesn't feel that item really needs to be addressed, then we can always, you know, you always have the option to go ahead and vote on that. With the overrides, maintenance and operations override, first can only be used on maintenance and operations items. So again, if all of a sudden we're short capital funds, we can't take from the maintenance and operations override to pay for those capital items. Also in the maintenance and operations override, there are limitations to what was put forward in the pamphlet. So when we did the pamphlet and we asked for a maintenance and operations override, we specified six different categories of things that we were going to use those funds for. For bond, maintenance and operations override, and the capital override, we do an annual report where we recap everything that we spent that year, broken down by each one of the different categories, which each category that ties back to the bond pamphlet. So the one that I do for capital, that's that extremely long one. It has like a little ruler and little graphics along the side of it. I've been using Karen's same format since she left. So that's that one. It's like about 25, 30 slides long, and I recap every single project that we've had in every single category. Same
is that
with
on
the
website too? Some, like, is it near the cap CIP plan, or is that annual report?
Not the
report?
PowerPoint. We don't put the PowerPoint up. We always could find a place to put the PowerPoint, but we haven't in the past put the PowerPoint slides up there. But I can always look at that. I can look at, see if I can find a good spot where we could start inserting the PowerPoint presentation from each year. Maybe even the recorded video from these meetings so they can actually see the delivery of the PowerPoint. Not that I'm that thrilling to watch on video, but maybe there might be some extra context in there for them. So we do have those limitations that fall for each one of those three categories, and we have to report back on each of those items each year to show that we are complying with what the voters authorize us to use those funds for. In terms of making them more restrictive, you know, I don't know, like if I was even to try to come up with a concept on how to make it more restrictive.
Well, if it's more about
sure
John's point that we want to be more clear, could it be instead of restrictive, more descriptive?
Well, yeah, and that's kind of why I asked, was this from ASBA or from us? Because I'm not going to say what I was going to say. This is, it's not conclusive enough. It's not direct. It's just, you know, it's kind of nebulous. And I want to make sure that if we're going to have this in there, that we pinpoint exactly what we're saying. And I'm not sure that I even understand what this means by more restrictive. So, but I think what'd you say? More
descriptive. You know, or you could say more clear or more clarifying or.
When it comes to how we spend our money, I feel that we as a district have done a really great job with our capital improvement plan. And I know that there have been times where I've questioned items on the capital improvement plan. And I think that all of us on the board need to understand. And Jeremy, it might not be a bad idea to maybe give us the last 3 years, because I know of the capital improvement plan and, you know, even some of the technology override projections that you've had of how that money's been spent. Because I do recall when we had to table many of the items on the capital improvement plan because of what we were going through. So, you know, again, that is a place where I absolutely, when it's bond money, when it's taxpayer money, you know, I feel that that is a fiduciary responsibility for myself and I think for the rest of the board to fully comprehend, to understand, to know that in 5 years, you know, we're going to be replacing certain roofs. I know that after some of the issues we've had at some of the campuses, to know that, okay, as a parent with the student sitting in a building, I know that this year this is happening, and then each additional subsequent year we're moving forward in the right direction. So, and again, I think one thing that I know this board, or the previous board, was holding Jeremy and his team very accountable with what, you know, just because it says on a piece of paper, this is my favorite thing to say, just because it says that it's time to put a new air conditioning in, just like at home, doesn't mean that I'm going to get a new air conditioner. So if it's not broken, we're not going to replace it. But if it's on the plan and we might have a few extra years on something, then we often are able to work with it depending on the funding. I mean, I think that So again, going back to this number three, restrictive, I think I do like Michelle's idea of doing something more descriptive, maybe a way to say, to be more descriptive in how the bond money and override money can be used by following or by having a comprehensive annual capital improvement plan maybe listed or a link to it on the site.
And let's keep in mind, this is what we're suggesting ASBA lobby for. And so if all school districts, I've heard this a million times, that if all school districts did as good a job as we do about communicating our budget and our capital improvement plan, then there would be not only greater understanding, but anyway, it would be very positive if all school districts did as good a job as we did. So this, where we would basically be saying, we would encourage ASBA to lobby that all school districts do a good job of being more descriptive in how bond money and override money can be used.
And Kristen has a question here. So yeah, Ms. Middleton.
Well, I just want to make it clear that this was, you know, a gathering of everyone's ideas, including the language. And I like Michelle's idea of the descriptive. So thank you for the input.
So if you all like that idea, you could amend that statement to, you know, whatever Michelle just said, and I think Kristen echoed it, and then act on this if you wanted to change it.
When would we act on it?
You're supposed to be voting on this tonight.
Yeah.
So
can we accept it in the amended form and then?
Yes,
then
you can. Okay.
So I'll go ahead and read the final right here. Like Michelle was recapping, I'll just pick up where you left off about specific issues for 2016. These should be specific items for bill introduction. And the first one was change override budget increase to locally controlled funding. We all seem to support that. Number two.
Hold on. The locally controlled funding means nothing to anybody. And I'm concerned about accepting that. Because when you put in locally controlled funding, it's a ruse. And I would rather see honesty. It's an override and budget increase. Let's be real about it, okay? People may like it, they may not, but everyone's gonna say, well, what's a locally controlled funding? What is that? Oh, you mean it's a budget increase, okay. So why are we dancing?
Well, I think from my years of understanding this is that when there's ballot language that is asking voters to approve a budget increase, it can be perceived as we are increasing the budget when we're actually not. It's often a continuation of what we're already doing. So if I'm a voter sitting at home and thinking, well, why would I support spending more money if that's not how I feel? But would I support a continuation of what we're already doing? So, you know, I don't favor locally controlled funding over something else, but I think that there does need to be wording that will be more clear to voters.
I just think locally controlled funding means nothing. If we could put something in there that's more descriptive, that it would be better than locally controlled funding.
You know, Jeremy may have a point on this, but I believe that the ballot language used to be able to say that it would be a continuation.
We can. That's what we did last
time.
Can we
still say that?
Yes. Okay. If you're continuing your override at the same percentage,
right,
then it's a continuation.
Okay.
For maintenance and operations overrides, for example, if you had 15% and you've already phased down to 10 and you're trying to get back to 15,
right,
at that point you're asking for an increase and it has to say increase.
Okay. So we are able to say the continuation language. You know, but on this
Thanks.
One, you just have to decide whether or not this is a statement the board would like to see representing you or not. You know, you could simply remove it if you wanted to.
Can we just say something here? Because I think depending on what it is, the language is going to change. So can we just say something that doesn't lock us into this locally controlled funding thing? Because that's what turned me off here. If you want to change the override budget increase because it's a little negative connotation, I'm okay with that, but use something that has
meaning. You know, it makes me think of the conversation you were having on number three, you know, above that, because you talked about being more descriptive. I wonder if you thought about that, change override budget increase to a more descriptive phrase to better reflect, you know, so I mean, you could be a little vague about how it's worded, but
that's fine.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
You know, I think we need to remember too that this is something that goes to ASBA, and I'm not certain. I mean,
yeah, let's be realistic. 227 school districts are going
to
submit this.
With all
I don't know if anybody
ASBA,
cares that much,
much
what
they,
we say.
Well, as I say, that's one of the reasons why ASBA limited to this short list, and basically, although they don't require it, they suggest that you pick one of the items from the short list because that makes it easier for them to tally when it gets back to them, because then they're just going to do the top three out of each category.
Although I'm all in favor if they look and it says this came from Kyrene, and they're like, let's just go with this. They know everything over there. So doubt that'll happen, though.
I'm good friends with Janice, but yeah, I still don't think
not
she's
that
going
good.
That way. So.
So I'm okay with changing it to language that is more descriptive to better reflect what voters are being asked to support. That's fine.
I like that better.
Does the rest of the board feel okay with that?
Yep.
Okay. So then let's just go ahead. We've all read the final two. So let's, do I have a motion to approve the ASBA political agenda priorities with the stated changes for the 2016 legislative session?
I motion to approve the ASBA stated priorities.
As amended?
As amended. Thank you.
I'll second that.
Okay. A motion by Ms. Middleton and a second by Mr. King. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And thank you, Kristen. Good job.
Yeah, thank you. Motion passes 4-0. And yes, you know, it was one of those things when we asked you to do it, we appreciate it. And Kristen was very diligent and followed up with all of us, and I appreciate it because I didn't want to do it this time.
Well, we didn't really ask her.
Yeah, we
he
did.
He just all said, who's going to do it, and pointed fingers.
There I was voluntold. So.
Voluntold.
Well, we appreciate it. Thank you, Kristen.
I like that.
Okay, moving on to item 8.08, purchasing authorization, approve the issuance of the request for proposal superintendent search consulting service. And I'm going to assume that might be...
I think I know that
Jessica.
Yeah, Jessica's here and Jackie's here, and so you know you have the item in front of you. This is just the RFP mainly, but if you have any questions, we have people here that can answer them. Otherwise, okay.
Whole page four and stuff here.
I just have one, so John can go first and maybe he'll answer mine.
Okay, so is anyone gonna
okay.
Okay, go John.
Do you have anything you want to say first, or you just want me to dive in? Okay. I wrote down the order I want to ask them in. So how are the qualified search firms identified over all the other search firms?
The solicitation will be posted on a public website, AZ Purchasing, under Professional Services, Human Resource Consultants. We've got about 62 vendors that have come up under that category. We also reached out to neighboring districts who have done this type of solicitation recently, and so we have about another 7 or 8 vendors.
Okay. And the next one is tied to that. You just answered, how are they going to know of our request for our request for an RFP? All right, and then what about the response time frames? Well, what are we looking at there? I know there's a schedule there, but they're going to have to respond pretty quick to this. And there's, a lot of it is just legal stuff, but there's that one page that just talks about these are the parameters, which I'm going to get into in just a minute. But these are the things that they're going to have to respond to and say, this is how we typically do things. And are we going to ask them to send us any examples of past work or anything like that? Are we able to do that?
I believe that's in the solicitation, yes.
I'm sorry, say it again.
I believe that's in the solicitation.
Okay. All right, on page 22, it talks about the services listed. I'm just going to go to that now so I can talk to it more specifically. Just give me a second while I get there. Okay, 22. Services requested.
I already have the page printed.
It says in B, in cooperation with the board, develop a candidate profile and criteria evaluation selection of a successful candidate for a superintendent. And are they going to provide to us their methodology for accomplishing that? Is that the intent for having that in there? I mean, just simply asking us is one thing, but I think that they probably have a method that they use. You know, they go through a certain type of individual interviews and things like that.
And I can be corrected if I'm wrong. My understanding is that they would actually work with you individually as a board, and together the board and the search firm come up with the criteria that then you're going to use to go and recruit
candidates. And the way that they do that, do they give us a document with some questions on it that we answer to set up our individual perspective of profiles and things like that?
They could probably do it however the board would like for them to do.
Yeah, I think that's where I'm going with this, is that before they begin doing that, that we all have a conversation and we say, this is how we want you to do it. These are the criteria that we think are critical. These are the ones that are important, and these are the nice to have ones. Okay.
We haven't seen the responses, obviously, but once we get them and you review them, we can certainly ask for clarification or more information from the vendors that have responded.
Okay. On page 24, there's this, this is the questionnaire you send out to their references. And on this it says, number four says, participation of key employees in the selection process. As one of the evaluations. However, on the previous page, 22, that we were looking at, nothing is said in there about employee participation at all. So I'm just curious why it was absent in one and exists in the other. Sorry, it's the way I am. But if you could just, you know, look at that and see, I need to understand what's going on with that, because as I understand it, and Jessica, correct me where I'm wrong, it's the board's responsibility to select and hire a superintendent. And it's up to us to have discretion over whether or not we involve from the employee group to participate with us. Is that right? Okay.
Yeah, Mr. King, my understanding would be, again, that once you've selected a search firm, the criteria and how they work with the board is really entirely up to the board of how involved or not involved a board wants to be. But typically boards, rightfully so, do want to be involved. And so once you have a vendor selected, that vendor is going to work with you to make sure the process is what you would like.
That's going to be one of the components, one of the characteristics of the of their being selected, is their ability to work with the entire board, because I expect our entire board to be involved in this. Okay, and so so the thing about the employee involvement, that's the part that I'm not sure I understand how it works and that sort of thing. I think there's 5 votes and not more than that, because there's 5 members on the board. But certainly we'd like to hear from the employee groups. We don't want to hear from every one of the employees, so maybe we come up with someone that's an employee advisory person that, you know, we select. But
can I just interrupt
that person?
Because I think, if you're talking about page 24, that, correct me if I'm wrong, is a performance evaluation survey on the vendor that we're selecting, not on the superintendent.
No, it's completely about the company that we're, the organization we're going to select through the RFP process. But my point was that we're sending this out to all of their references, mm-hmm. so we can evaluate how they've performed in the past. and it has that thing about employees there. But when you go look at the criteria that we've established to look at on page 22, there's not, the word employee doesn't show up in there anywhere. And there's, that's a distinct difference to me.
So are you saying that in the scope of work, we are not asking them to work with employees, but we're
if I was
asking
at,
how good of a job yeah. they do on that task?
Well, you know, I mean, if I was looking at this, if I was in their shoes looking at this, and I would see what my criteria is, and then I would say, well, why don't they want to know about what we're doing? Like, why don't we just go ahead and put something in there about how we've worked with employees in the past? Because we'd like to know.
So just so I'm clear, John, when you say how they are working with employees, you mean
the search firm.
Okay, but yeah. they're only, from what I understand, they're only going to work or communicate with employees based on what the board tells them to do. Am I correct?
That's right. But they do this all the time. We're doing it once. So I'd like to know what their experience is. What have other boards done? And so how have they done that?
So what we can do, so you're saying in the RFP, you want to add a line item that says, how have you in the past?
I'm not really sure how to word it, but I think if we're going to ask this in the reference information, we probably should have something that matches it in the criteria list.
See, because what I would identify that with is number three, which is the ability to grasp and understand the needs of the district to some level, and then ability number seven to follow the district rules, regulations, and requirements, or number eight,
do you know the best way to involve the employee group?
I think that how we involve the employee group is how the five board members.
But wouldn't it be, I know that, but wouldn't it be nice to know how others have done it so we can just say, well, I kind of like that one, but I like to tweak it a little
well,
bit.
Well, and one thing, see the number, which is D, which is...
in cooperation with the board, develop and implement a candidate marketing and recruitment plan, which includes the distribution of relevant materials, advertising the position, and conducting a national search, which includes advice to the board on the appropriate compensation. But... I mean, that just says what the plan will include. So we want the plan to include
advice on how we work with employees. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. I just want to know that if we're hiring this company, that they have had experience having employees participate with the board.
John,
and if they can share with us what they've seen as something that works and things that don't work.
I think I might be able to help. If you look at it's not worded exactly the way you're saying it, but it says develop and implement a public information and participation program to ensure access by interested citizens. So maybe that's getting at it.
To offer constructive input.
It doesn't really use the word employees, but you could imply that it means employees, or you could add it.
Maybe citizens and employees?
Yeah, you can do that.
Mm-hmm. I'm fine with that.
And, you know, I think that's all I'm asking is just that we are consistent in our packaging.
Does that sound okay, Jessica?
Yes.
So one of the other items that, I think it somewhere down this process is we'll, as a board, have to decide and appoint some sort of a facilitator, and that's something that's, from what I understand, they've done in the past. So someone possibly within the staff, that's generally someone that's here that would be, and when does that happen? When would we do that? Where at in the process?
I imagine that you'd want to do that early on, but that it could be any time between the time the governing board adopts the RFP into, I'm thinking, the next couple months.
Okay. Does that make
sense? Yes, the first process, that part of the process is to select the search firm.
Correct.
All right. And then as we're developing the specific criteria that they will use to go out and do the search, then we will solicit the services of an what'd you call them, an advisor, advocate, or something like
that? A board liaison.
So that we can make sure we've got a good 360 perspective, that because we might miss something entirely. Yeah. Okay? Yeah. Anybody else? I'm done.
Any other questions? Okay. Are we ready to move on to a motion for item number 8.08?
I'll motion to accept the purchasing authorization to approve the issuance of the request for proposal, Superintendent Search Consulting Services, as amended.
I'll second.
Okay. We have a motion by Mr. King, a second by Ms. Middleton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Thank you. Okay. 9.0 items for future.
Actually,
oh, sorry.
Yes, Madam
we moved
Vice
something
President,
to 8.09.
Yeah, we actually have three because we took two other ones off.
Okay.
So I believe 8.09 is about the educational support professional reclassification. And there was some wording or some typo there. So Mark was going to clear that up for us. So Mark, do you want to take that?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Schauer. And Vice President, members of the Governing Board, community. Yes, Mrs. Hirsch, her eagle eye came out, so thank you very much, Mrs. Hirsch. And on page 4 of that first attached document, the document that we're referring to is the reclassification review process, and that was the one we're modifying. What we're recommending, that is in section 9B, that we strike out those dates, because they refer to the dates this year, and replace that with the following sentence. Classification review requests may be submitted during a 30-day window period each fall. That way we don't have to amend this document each year. So if we keep it generic and have it reflect what our practice is, I think that would be a satisfactory solution.
Okay, could I get a motion reflecting the change on 7.07 as item number 8.09, right? Yes?
So I'll make a motion to approve the education support professionals reclassification process revisions with the 30-day timeframe that Dr. Knight mentioned.
I'll second, as okay. amended.
A motion by Mrs. Hirsch, second by Mr. King. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Now we will move on to 7.8. Substitute rates of pay for temporary employment. Correct.
This for me goes back to what I said earlier. I'm going to question anytime you want to raise something, I want to question it because I want to understand that you've got a long-term plan for how you're going to back it up.
Okay. Fair question. One of the things we did a number of years ago, Mr. King, is we fixed our substitute budget. And I believe, and I'm looking for Jackie, I want to say it's fixed at $868,000. That's the fixed budget for substitutes. And that's the amount that goes out that the schools have. And so then we take that amount of money and we then allocate a percentage of it to each school based on their FTE. So what this reflects is the fact that we're having a little bit of difficulty filling classrooms. We do have a pretty decent sub-fill rate. It's about 96%. The final numbers will actually be coming in any day, and I'll get those in our board memo so you can see them. But they vary by school. What we did is we took a look at the competitors, their daily rates of the two school districts that we mostly compete with. We wanted to make sure that our daily rate matched theirs. We're a little bit under. And by the way, some of our subs will actually teach in Kyrene as well as other districts. We don't want them to be choosing to go to other districts. We want them to choose Kyrene. So that's why we're recommending that the Governing Board consider raising the daily rate for subs. The other item that we're recommending that the Governing Board take a look at in terms of an increase would be the permanent subs. Last year, we were hoping to have six permanent subs on board. These are folks who agree to work every single day, and then we can deploy them at the last minute, because a significant percentage of our absences actually come in after 6 o'clock in the morning. And so we deploy our permanent subs to positions, to schools that might have one or two positions still open. We're finding out that we only ended the school year with, we had three, it dropped down to two permanent subs. We figure if we can up that by $10, we might be able to attract more generalist subs who are interested in performing such a role. They don't know what school they're going to in the last minute. And so that's why we're asking for a slight increase over what a regular substitute would get. So those are the two recommendations we have before you.
What's the total hit to the budget?
Well, it's going to be budget neutral, because there's a fixed budget, a sub-budget of $868,000. Some schools, for their portion, come under that. Some schools go over that. But we have not exceeded that budget that we set up 4 years ago. So this is going to be budget neutral. When schools run out of money, they run out of money. And so they have to have these conversations with their staffs at staff meetings about their sub-budget and how that's looking. They do have plan Bs when they can't fill it with the sub.
And that was the $24,000 question. Okay. So, and that's what I needed to know.
Okay,
there.
Thank you. All right. I'll keep that in mind for our future recommendations.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Okay.
Okay.
So with that, I'll make a motion to approve substitute rates of pay for temporary employment.
I'll second. Aye.
Motion passes 4-0. Okay, I think now we are moving on. 7.9.
I'm finding it.
You know, this isn't fair. When Ross is gone, you guys have to go and change this all around on me. And okay, 7.9, which is the teacher evaluation and growth systems.
On page 7, this was something, maybe I just don't understand how this works. This was about a proficiency scale, right, for probationary teachers. And it says at least 65% at levels 3 and/or 4 with no scores of 0. Can you tell me what that means?
Yes. The recommended change, this is the rating formula that's behind our teacher evaluation instrument. And so, you know, teachers, our goal is that teachers get somewhere between 30 and 50 observation data points dropped into their evaluation during the course of the year. And one of the key domains, the instructional practice domain in our evaluation instrument, then 15 other ratings in other domains. But that's the key one, the instructional domain. And so one of the pieces of feedback of the teacher evaluation design team, that's a group that consists, it's a majority teacher group, advisory group that works with some administrators, and they look at the evaluation instrument and come up with ways to just continue to improve that process. So one of the recommendations that came forward was that we add the language with no scores of 0, and that's based on feedback that we had from principals that if you think about the fact that if 65% of the data points are being dropped into teacher evaluations is 3, which is, you know, highly effective, or 4 is effective, that's great. But if there's a third of them that are zeros or ones, indicating that the teacher is getting that a certain indicator that we're looking at or an element we're looking at isn't present, or it's developing, or it's beginning, that doesn't make sense, how a teacher can still be rated highly effective. Sure. The recommendation was, if someone's going to be rated highly effective, they shouldn't have any zeros dropped on any elements that are observed. And so that's really the history behind that change.
So why under the effective column you don't also have it there, if that's the explanation?
The distinction that we're making there is that a highly effective, the rating of highly effective should really be the exemplary level that we see of our master teachers. Teachers can still be effective and still be working on particular elements. So the feeling of the team was, and I'm just representing the team, was that that language would be appropriate and highly effective, but not effective. We also, one of the things we're looking at on this team is we're looking at what the Marzano model recommends. And so we're trying to move closer to that ideal of what the Marzano recommends. in the Marzano recommendation, they have the with no scores at zero and highly effective, but they don't have that effective. So we're just trying to emulate that a little bit. Okay. But this is looked at each year.
Okay, thank you. But with that, I'll make a motion to approve this as well.
Second. Okay, motion by Mr. King, second by Mrs. Hirsch. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Now we're at items for future consideration. Do any board members want to list any additional items? Mrs. Hirsch.
Thanks. I would like to add, sorry, I thought I wrote it down, that the board review the communication strategies and procedural guidelines in our next issue review session, particularly in regards to the role and responsibilities of the president in speaking for the board.
Cindy, you got that? Okay. Anyone else?
Yep.
Mr. King?
We've been getting reports at various times that reflect performance against the blueprint. And I think it would be better if we could have certain points in time in the year where we get those reports, so it becomes more laser focused for us, because if it's kind of just thrown in with everything else, we might miss that. So I'd like to see us set maybe quarterly with something we talked about, review points, and so we can look at what's going on and get a little closer to what's happening at the time that it's happening.
So something as a calendar type of our reporting?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I think we've talked about that before, and I think okay, Cindy, you got that? Come on, Kristen, you got something? Just kidding.
Not yet.
Just nominate you for another task. Okay, meeting dates. Item 10.0, the next issue review and regular meeting is scheduled for June 9th. And the final 11.0, the adjournment, may I have a motion to adjourn this evening's meeting?
I motion to adjourn this meeting.
There's a great task.
Okay. Second.
Okay, motion by Mrs. Middleton, a second by Mrs. Hirsch. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. The meeting is adjourned at 7:38, not 8:38. Thank you.